Hi there, this is Anthony Serna, and today with Anthony we're going to talk about certain topics here. The first one will be why we should not eat fat. What's wrong about fat?
Oh, the fat on fat? Well, you really can't eat fat without getting sick. I found that for myself, and fats are just unnecessary, so stick with fruits, you're a lot better with that. It's just,
What about nature? Don't animals eat fat?
Not that, I mean, I'm sure maybe there's some animals that do, but not that I've seen living on farms and communities. It's not really the preferred food source for a lot of the animals that resemble us. Birds, of course, will eat seeds, so that has the fats in it, let's say. Some rats might chew on some avocados here and there. But in general, I haven't found maggots growing around an avocado, or animals that generally eat sweet carbohydrates to go with avocados. And I know when I did used to eat avocados, I would feel really sluggish and tired and bogged down. And if you were an animal in nature and it was required of you to use your energy to get more food or to run away from predators or some sort of threat, you don't want to be bogged down and sloshy, you know, with any kind of fat you've consumed.
Mm-hmm. Okay, so what about oil? Oh. We hear so many great things about olive oil and French cuisine and Italian cuisine. What about oil?
If you take a glass and you fill it with water and oil, see that water and oil separates. Majority, from what I've understood, of our bodies is composed of water. So when we put oil with the water, we're going to separate. We're going to cause a constipation, as you will, inside the vessel, some sort of blockage. And the blockage is caused by the oil that we consume. And we really, there's no need to consume oil at all. You know, you can function just well without any oil. There's a lot of wonderful authors that are great speakers and great writers that will talk about, you know, the fats that heal, the fats that kill. I found that to be complete nonsense. You never see a marathon runner or an endurance athlete or in general performance athlete chug down a bottle of oil before they compete, you know, before you're gonna do something, because it's gonna bog you down, it's gonna make you very sick. So it's also going to cause a great burden for your organs, including your liver.
So what do the marathon runners do?
Generally, they either fast, you know, before the event. I mean, as I wrestled, I also didn't eat anything before my event. But an endurance athlete also is going to consume maybe carbs. I know I used to chug down syrups, grade B maple syrup, you know, sweetened items. Some have these little gel packs that's just nothing but sweet sugar.
Mm-hmm. So carbs. So sugar isn't bad for you?
No, that's all I live on. I live on sugar.
You're kidding me. Wait a minute. We are told everywhere, and our kids are told to avoid sugar. And when we see pies and donuts and so on, we hear, don't eat it because it's sugar. Can you comment on that?
Oh, yeah. I mean, the cakes, donuts, pies, ice cream, everything that you think, chocolate bars, it's all wrapped up fat. And so the sugars, you know, your body becomes insulin resistant. But just look at the idea of a chocolate bar. You know, think it's the sugar that's hurting you, but in reality, it's the process, the fact that you're eating all this cocoa butter. You know, it is butter. It's disgusting. It's brown butter and some sugar. And you're eating the brown, bitter butter and with a lot of sugar, so you think it's really tasty. And it's actually causing a lot of obstruction in your body. That applies to cakes and pies, so the butter with the eggs, with the nasty stuff in there that's gonna cause an obstruction in your body. So for me, I'd rather eat bananas and peaches and pears any day of the week versus any food, not just as a treat or as a dessert, but as a fuel source, if I'm looking at it as a fuel source.
Mm-hmm. What else do you eat?
Water, fruits, watery fruits. That's pretty much all I really know.
So you eat bananas, peaches, and pears. And when I ask
apples,
what else, you say water?
No, apples, oranges. I mean, okay. The fact is, it's when you talk about nutrition or foods, what we eat, for some reason, a lot of these great nutritionists and dietitians and great authors fail to address your environment, your air that you breathe in. That's actually nourishment. You know, you're going to drop dead a lot sooner with lack of air than you will with lack of food. Mm-hmm. So in my opinion, based on that, I would say that the air is more valuable than, the quality of the air is more valuable than the food. Why don't we come talk about that? We talk about GMO foods all the time. No one talks about the GMO air, quote unquote. I'm not saying GMO, but polluted air, toxic air. That's gonna cause more degeneration of your health than food, because you shouldn't be eating that stuff anyway, the garbage.
When you eat fruit, do you ever worry about fruit being organic or not organic? Which one is your preference?
My preference, depending on the economy of it, the availability of it, and also the integrity of the people that are telling me, like the USDA, United States Department of Agricultural Inspection, their standards for organic allow for a lot of things that you may not be aware of. I mean, as an example, a lot of the water that's being used comes from feedlots and is contaminated with feces from animals and other chemicals. You got acid rain, you got no control over that. You got the environment pollutions. So you really have a lot less control than you think, just if it's not sprayed. That's just an added discomfort. But as far as like anyone that's transitioning to from where they're at to a mostly fruit-based diet, if not entirely fruit-based diet, they shouldn't concern themselves. No one should concern themselves that greatly with this thing, because it becomes a barrier. It becomes a challenge to go 100% fruit or
right. 80%. It's a lot of people say, I cannot afford it, so I'm not gonna do this, and they end up eating crap.
Yeah.
You know, or they want?
Or they don't want to do GMO fruits and vegetables because they're so sprayed and got chemicals. Well, any kind of meat you're going to eat is all chemically treated. All meats, all cheeses, all dairies, eggs, they have to treat them before you eat for just storage and then for consumption. And anything processed and packaged has been treated.
All sorts of meat, even meat that's organic?
Yeah, I mean, think about it. You cut yourself, your blood's going to turn brown. You know, I mean, you can hardly ever see meat being sold as brown or gray or greenish looking, and that's kind of there's shades of color when things are rotting, and that's what flesh is. So if you have a choice of eating, you know, meats and all these other things or fruit, go with fruit. People tell me, well, what if there's nothing else to eat? Well, then don't eat anything that day. You're fine. You're not going to die from not eating one day. You know, you deserve the highest quality of value, and you're not going to get that from eating glue. You know, glue is pretty much made out of all animal products, all animal flesh.
What do you mean glue?
Boil down the muscle of an animal. You know, if you eat steak or something, boil it down, it becomes collagen. It becomes like a mucus, pussy, sticky paste. The same applies to potatoes and rice. It becomes the same glue that a carpenter would use back in the day, or a bookkeeper, a bookbinder, excuse me, to bind books and to buy shelving, you know, to bind these things. Whereas if it's fruit, fruit's going to boil down to molasses and syrup. You know, those things, they're sticky, but they leave your body a lot faster. And that's kind of the goal. You want to avoid things that are going to stay in your body for predetermined, you know, for a longer period of time. And a lot of these nutritionists and dietitians and great authors, they fail to address how long something should stay in your body before it becomes a nuisance.